Welcome everyone to another edition of Play It Through, and on this edition it's Kid Chameleon, brought to us by Sega. Kid Chameleon is an action platformer with tons of different levels and secrets to discover. You play as Casey, who is kind of like the cool kid on the block, and goes to play a new arcade game known as Wildside. The thing about Wildside is the main boss of the game, Heady Metal, has been abducting all the kids into the game that were unable to beat it. So now Casey must defeat Heady Metal by going through all the levels of the game, in which case he'll also free the children that have been captured. Kind of a weird premise, but you play as this main character who actually travels inside of the arcade cabinet himself, and uses different masks that you find throughout the levels in order to transform into different forms in order to get through different hazards and defeat certain enemies in the game. So here we go with Kid Chameleon for the Sega Genesis. Now, Kid Chameleon, like I said, has tons of different levels and many different secrets to discover. There's a total of 103 different levels in Kid Chameleon, including 32 special levels known as Elsewhere. Now, in this run of the game, I will not be showing every single level since it's impossible to show every level during a normal playthrough of the game. Instead, what I'm going to do is take a path that will actually allow me to enter the most amount of levels possible during a normal run of the game. When you start the game, you can play one or two players, and also check out the option menu where you get to actually see Heady Metal himself in the background, and you'll see him quite a few times throughout the game. Now the only thing I will be changing here is actually changing the speed button from the normal or slow mode to the fast mode. Basically what this does is it allows me to go the fastest at all times without having to hold down the A button, which will actually make me walk slower in this version of the game. As you start off the game, you're greeted with some pretty bright colors and some really good graphics for the Sega Genesis. Right near the very beginning, we grab our first head power. This is Iron Knight. Like I mentioned, there are a bunch of different heads that we're going to be getting throughout the run of the game, and I will be showing most of them during the run. There is a couple, though, I won't be getting, but I'll mention them as we go along. The Iron Knight is one of the more useful of the abilities because he has a larger amount of health than any other character mask in the game, as well as actually able to climb up walls, so we're going to be him several different times throughout this game. After completing a level, you make it to a flag. Now, other times, you'll be going through warp zones in order to go to different levels or different parts of levels, and we'll see tons of them throughout the game. At the beginning of the next level, we immediately drop down a hole since we're unable to get past the barricade to the right, down here jumping on the heads of different enemies to try to avoid any damage, and then using the Iron Knight's head in order to break through the rocks up here so that we can jump up. The game does use a momentum system with jumping, whether you're walking slow or moving fast, and you're going to have to master the mechanics in order to get to higher platforms throughout the game. One of the other big pitfalls of the game that you're going to be dealing with is spikes, and sometimes there may be spikes just on the ground themselves taking you out, or different platforms will actually have spikes in them. Now over here on this very last block, if you're able to climb to it and duck down and hold the buttons, you'll actually warp all the way to the very last level of the game. Yes, you can beat the game that quickly. Like I mentioned before, there's 103 levels, but in order to beat the game the quickest, you actually only have to do 3 levels. However, of course, we're not going to be doing that in this run. Instead, we complete the level and move on to the next stage. Here we end up grabbing Berserker. Now Berserker, as you can see, well, he has a spiked football-like helmet. He's able to run through different enemies with his charge ability. He can also knock metal blocks away and allow us to get through different openings. Up here, we'll climb up and switch back over to the Iron Knight in order to climb up the wall and then jump up to the very top portion. Here we switch right back over the Berserker and bust through the wall in order to get across the spiky gap. Now the way the health and all works in the game is that you have a certain health bar for each of the heads that you have. Now you only have one head at a time, so once I lose this mask, I'll go back to the regular King Chameleon form, and then I'll have to find another mask. Switching mask at any point though will instantly give you full health for whatever mask you currently just picked up. You also have collectible diamonds that you'll be getting throughout the levels, which actually, after getting a certain amount of them, you'll be able to do special moves. Each mask has a special move that you'll be doing, and you use the diamonds in order to use those moves. I'll only be doing one of the special moves really throughout the run, because I have to conserve my diamonds, and that'll really be the force field ability, which protects me with invincibility for a short period of time. Above the diamond counter, though, is your Ankhs, and the Ankhs represent, well, your lives in the game. After you fall down certain pits, or you end up losing all your health as the Kid Chameleon form, you'll end up losing a life. Of course, you'll then have to start back at the beginning of the area. Every level has a 3-minute time limit. You can see it counting down in the upper left corner. After, of course, it reaches zero, you end up losing a life and having to restart. There's also another speed gimmick in the game. As you've noticed with some of the levels, if you complete a level fast enough, you'll end up getting a speed bonus at the end. Over here, you want to climb up here and get on this teleporter to go to the first of the Elsewhere levels. We're then bouncing as the Red Samurai-esque character known as Red Stealth, and he'll bounce up here, and as the blocks disappear, you want to land on top of them just as they reappear. Climbing all the way to the top, we end up getting the Cyclone ability. Now, this is a mask that we're going to be using a lot throughout the game. Basically, there's going to be two masks that we're going to be using a lot, as they help us speed through levels a little bit quicker. As the Cyclone, mashing the ability button, will of course turn you into a tornado. Doing so will allow you to fly up to different levels. Right there, I just unlocked the Maniac's mask. Now, I won't be picking it up, but basically you become a big hulking Jason Voorhees-esque character, actually very similar to Rick from the Splatterhouse series. You're also wielding an axe, so it makes more sense to be more closely related to Splatterhouse's Rick. In that form, you have a limited amount of health, but you can take out enemies with the axe, which isn't that beneficial overall to this run. Making it through the next level, we make it to the very bottom here, and of course we complete the stage, getting to see all our bonuses, including not picking up any prizes, as well as not getting hit, and other different bonuses you'll get for completing levels to rack up your total score. At the beginning of the next level, we immediately use that Cyclone ability to start spinning our way right around the top area. There's lots of different enemies falling from the ceiling during this portion of time as we make our way across. Some of the worst enemies in the game are not only the perils that you'll see, like lava flying upwards or things dripping, but also these little tiny monkey-like characters that will pop out of walls from time to time, and you'll have to do your best to avoid them. Now, you can jump on their head in order to actually defeat them, but they sometimes come out of completely random spots, it seems like, so unless you've memorized every location they can pop out of, they can be a little bit difficult to prepare for. At the beginning of the next stage, once again, use your Cyclone ability, and you can see you can actually, like, fly with it, moving up and down through different areas, allowing you to bypass some of the more mundane platforming segments of the game. Here we have these moving platforms up and down. We use the Cyclone, though, to head up to the very top in order to hit the spike walls that end up shooting out these darts and end up hitting the blocks to the right. On any of the blocks that you hit that end up shooting out spikes, which can actually hurt you as well, they'll have openings on the square itself, either up, down, left, or right, and whatever openings they have is where arrows will start flying once you've made contact. Of course, once you've done so also, anything that the arrows end up touching will end up doing damage or destroy it altogether, like certain blocks. I know, there's an absolute ton to talk about in this game, including, well, there's actually mini-bosses and bosses in the game. Well, at least I consider this guy a mini-boss. This lying-like guy we will see multiple times throughout the game, just like the main boss himself, and you jump on his head a few times in order to do damage. I only ended up defeating the very first one just to showcase you guys how to actually defeat one of these guys, but with the Cyclone ability, we're able to speed right up to the very top without having to do all the climbing, and make it to the flag at the top left corner. Like I mentioned before also, there are tons of different warps in the game. Like I said, there's over 30 bonus levels just by themselves. Warps in the game will not always take you to a bonus level. Like we saw in the second level of the game, they can warp you to, well, a later part of a particular stage, or even worse, warp you back to a previous part of the same stage. So unfortunately, the warps aren't always beneficial. Down here though, we will be getting a new ability. The new ability we get here is the Sky Cutter ability. Now this guy's kind of like Marty McFly from the Back to the Future movies, as he has a hoverboard in order to fly around. You reverse gravity while riding the hoverboard in order to flip the hoverboard itself upside down. Doing so, you'll move along the actual ceilings, or of course you can go along the ground themselves, reversing at any time in order to help you avoid enemies, jump over platforms, and such. When you hit an opening, like the open sky with no blocks on the top of it, you'll just bounce off of it, reversing gravity and facing back down. So you always have to be prepared when doing so, that when you bounce off the ceiling, you're ready for that reversal in gravity. This is an ability because it moves so fast that we'll be using quite often throughout this run. Be very careful in this area using your reversing gravity in order to make it to this platform down here to teleport. When you land on a teleport thing with the hoverboard, you only have to stand on the teleport for a few seconds before you will warp. In order to do so with the hoverboard, since you're constantly moving and you can't stand still, of course, unless running into a wall, what you'll have to do is hold down the A button to slow down a little bit, and then mash left and right real quickly in order to stay on the actual platform. Another cool thing you can do with the hoverboard itself is break blocks by doing the flip with gravity. While upside down, if you jump up, anything that you end up hitting with your head, because you're wearing a helmet, will do damage to enemies or destroy blocks. Doing a quick reversal of gravity at times will allow you to destroy certain blocks, creating little shortcuts in some of the levels. The flipping of gravity to break open blocks is definitely one of the more tricky things to do in the game, but it doesn't take too long to get used to it. One thing you'll notice also in the game is that even though there is 103 levels, the settings for the levels themselves only come in a handful of designs, whether they're the fire level, the ice level, the industrial city-like levels that like the sewer is or what we just saw, or like that tropical paradise island forest type setting. Like I said, you'll see these come and go in packs, usually two or three levels of the same type of genre, and then it'll switch over to a new type. Like for example, we had a few of the city, and now we're moving over to a few of the ice-themed levels. At the beginning of the level, we're using our gravity to once again get onto one of the ceiling type areas and ride most of the level across here. Thankfully, there's big open areas to really use the reversing gravity to help us out, and then eventually we come to the small cave, having to do the jump flips in order to open up the area. Once we've done so, and only after you've opened it up, then switch over to the Berserker Mask, which is located just to the right. Then run down here and break open the blocks by running into them. Doing so, you'll be able to make it to a set of spring-type areas and bounce up in order to get to the next warp. Once through the warp, over here, you'll have to jump up and then run into an opening in the wall. You'll be able to get another one of the Iron Knight Mask in order to help you up and climb. Now, it is possible, with perfect manipulation of the mechanics of jumping and momentum, you can actually make these higher jumps, including the one over the totem pole here. But it's rather difficult, and I was having trouble with doing so I just decided to use the Iron Knight Mask here. Which really doesn't hurt us since we don't need the Berserker Mask and we can get another one right away at the beginning of the next area when we do need it. After we've gone through another warp, we come back out to the other part of the ice level here. Once you make your way over to the right, change over to the red samurai character. Climb on top of these blocks that you can break and then bounce on the last set. Do not go down, instead head over to the right. Traveling down just takes you to another little path area where you can collect some extra bonus items, but overall it's not going to be able to complete the level that way. After a few more enemies, we grab a flag and complete another level. It may be tricky to actually pay attention to every single level I am going through as far as name and all. Usually going through a lot of the warps, if it takes me to a whole new area and not takes me to another part of the same level, usually means I went to one of the elsewhere levels. There's 30-some special bonus levels of the game. With our red samurai ability, just break open the blocks with all the different arrows shooting out of them, climb up here, and switch back over to the Berserker Mask. Here, we run into a whole bunch of blocks in order to open them up, and then we end up dropping down in the opening once this thing disappears. Hold left once you drop down in order to safely land on a teleporter. Doing so, you'll move to another part. Here, jump on the blocks in order to get them to go upwards. Hitting these types of blocks, you can actually raise them as far as possible, all the way to the very top or to another set of blocks above it. Climb up, breaking open some blocks along the way so that you have enough room in order to jump up, and then spring into an opening in the wall here. Once you're in here, be very careful of falling down to the spikes and a few of the dragon enemies running around. Break open a set of blocks to get another flag. While Kid Chameleon may not be the most popular of the Sega Genesis franchises, Sega has promoted the game over the years and even back then. It's been included in the Virtual Console and many other home compilations. It also received a PC version and actually got a comic book adaptation released a year after the game was released in 1993. And trust me, I understand if it's a little bit difficult to follow every single warp and everything going on in the run of the game. There's so much going on. There's so many levels to explore. Sometimes in later parts of the game, we're going to enter a level only to immediately go through a teleporter only a second or so into that level. Over here, we run all the way through openings to make our way down to the very bottom, but don't get the flag yet. Instead, we're going to open up some blocks in order to get to this P block in order to change back into the Red Samurai. Then we can run over and complete the level. The reason why we switch over to the Red Samurai is he's one of the better characters to take out the bosses in the game with, and it's time for the first boss of Heavy Metal. Here he is, well, a shish kebab on a spear. Three different weird eye-shaped heads are on this giant moving shish kebab arrow. It'll move back and forth, allowing you to attack it either front by using the sword ability of the samurai or jumping on top of him. Of course, jumping on top of him with openings as he rises up will be a good opportunity to hit him multiple times with jumps before he ends up squashing you on the very top portion when he hits the ceiling. You can stand on many different blocks in the areas in order to do damage to the head itself, and once you see his giant green eyeballs pop out of his skull, you know you've defeated that particular head. Once you've defeated all of them, the flag will appear and you can move on to the next level. This is the basic premise for every single boss that we'll be fighting in the game. Next up with the samurai, we're going to jump over these platforms, and as you can see, when you bounce on the heads of enemies, if you time the button presses correctly and the jumps correctly, you can actually spring off of them, getting a little bit of a boost to help you make it over certain areas a little bit quicker. Work our way through the tunnel down here, watching out for the drills that will come out of many of the different metal platforms. You basically see the metal platforms in the game be very wary of possible spikes. Now, a lot of them you're going to have to use in order to climb up the different areas and make your way around, but just always be cautious that a drill could pop out of any one of them. Thankfully, the drill is always set, so you know which ones each time you play will contain a drill. Up in the upper left corner of this big open area, we end up making it to a teleporter. Right away, jump up and destroy this P-block in order to get the Berserker helmet, in order to break through the walls and making it right over to this giant right side. Here you can just climb up the disappearing and reappearing blocks in order to get to another warp in the upper right corner. Immediately though, just knock over a block to the right using the Berserker and you complete the level. Interesting to note that all the levels in the game do have a speed number that you can get under in order to get a big bonus. One thing that's really funny, and I don't think they ever fixed it in any of the later versions of the game released, is the level Forbidden Tombs actually has a zero for the speedrun bonus, something that's impossible for it to beat. Just like the Running Man from Ocarina of Time, you'll never be able to get a zero, I guess without maybe using a Game Shark or a Game Genie or something, in order to keep your counter at zero at all times. Be careful at the bottom here for the jumping flames and then start climbing up, waiting for the blocks to disappear and then jump up in the air so that when they reappear, you'll land on top of them. The thing about this game, though, is you can't be landing on the same spot when they reappear. If you're at a spot where a block is about to reappear and it hits you, you'll end up losing a life a lot of the times. The game also has crush damage, that you'll be crushed by up and down moving platforms at any different time, and of course you'll lose a life when you get crushed. These are some of the worst hazards to deal with, especially when you want to make sure that you have a certain ability to help you through a particular level. Break up into blocks and drop down here, watching out for the symbiote-esque slime that is moving up and down, firing at you, as well as the bouncing fireballs. After you get up here, be very careful of the disappearing block, and then jump up so you can actually land on the next platform. Do some nice little timing here, and you'll be able to make your way all the way to the very top of this part. Run over to the right, jump across a couple of small gaps in order to make it to another teleporter. Doing so, you'll move on to another one of the elsewhere levels here. You can break up in the blocks if you want, just watch out for the lion, which this one's a little bit tougher than the one we saw earlier in the game because he moves a little bit faster. Thankfully though, we don't even have to fight these guys as we can easily get the teleporter to the left of the one at the bottom. Next up, watch out for the two-stepping dancing guys, and then climb all the way to the very top from platform to platform to get another warp. Here, what you want to do is use the samurai ability in order to break open some blocks. Then, you want to go over to the right side. Now, I accidentally end up getting a different ability than I wanted at first, but this is another one that we'll be seeing later on as well. That guy actually is pretty cool that he can actually find hidden blocks that no other ability can actually find. Either way, what you really want is the cyclone ability. Then head back over to the left and drop down the opening that we created. Of course, if you didn't accidentally create the opening earlier on, you'll have to actually make your way through the level the long way. But this makes the level a lot easier to travel through. Climb to the very, very bottom here, watching out for the up and down moving platforms so they don't end up getting squashed on the floor. And then drop down, and then all the way to the left and drop down again. Here's a whole bunch of more up and down moving platforms that can easily squash you, so be very cautious as you make your way through and make it to the flag at the far right side. One of the more annoying things about the game is that unfortunately it doesn't feature a save or a password system. Unfortunately, if you end up losing all your lives or you end up turning the game off and having to restart, you'll end up starting from the very beginning of the game and have to work your way through. And with so many levels, like I've mentioned multiple times, 103 levels, that's a pretty daunting task to do in one sitting. Over here, we can use our cyclone ability to really help us out, breaking through these blocks at the very bottom in order to get to the flag that's located just above. Now, during the beginning of the next level, we can just climb right up using the cyclone ability, bypass all the enemies, and another flag immediately hit. Things get even better though, because not only can we do it for that last level, the level before it we can do it by really quickly, we can do it for one more level we can beat in just a matter of seconds by holding on to the cyclone ability until we get here. Here, all you have to do is destroy this P-block. Destroy it, climb up using getting the diamond, and hit the flag in order to complete it. Of course, not doing the shortcut, you'll have to go the long way around, which involves, of course, going to the other side of the level and working your way through a series of platforms in order to get inside of that area. Unfortunately, though, that's where things stop for a little while as we make it to our next level, the Pyramid's Apparel. Here, use the cyclone ability up to the very top, hitting the spike thing so that it destroys all the next set of blocks for you before you actually try to walk underneath of it. Keep using the cyclone ability over the large gap areas, that way you don't have to do any of the little platforming. When you make it here, wait for the platform to go down so you can land on top of it, then wait for it to retract, hold down down in order to duck, and then crawl your way through the opening on the right side. Once through here, you'll hit a couple more spike blocks, watching out for the giant ram enemy, and then work your way down this ramp. Start up that big old cyclone ability, get to the upper right corner, and grab a new ability, the Iron Knight ability here once again, in order to break through all the blocks. Just jumping on them will destroy them. You'll have to jump on the P blocks multiple times though, in order to break them open, but you can collect a few items along the way. At the very bottom though, you're rewarded with the flag and move on to the next level. For the next level, we're going to make it through rather quickly, climbing up here, wait for the block to disappear, then go through the opening that's there. Then, climb up just a little bit, go through another couple of hidden openings in order to make it on top of a teleporter. At the beginning of the next area, break open this P block to become the Berserker, and then I end up running through the bottom blocks, but you don't need to do that. Instead, we actually want to climb upwards, watching out for the dancing guys here, and then break open the blocks over to the right, knocking away the metal blocks here in order to get inside this opening. Once inside here, the blocks can actually destroy one of the dancing guys that you'll see later on. Next up, jump over to the right and destroy one of the blocks, the metal blocks, moving them over. This will create an opening for you that you can actually get through by using the samurai ability over to the left that's hidden in the corner. Doing this, you'll have to do some really quick button mashing of jumping and holding down in order to break open the blocks, but it's not too difficult. You'll be able to get through, take a nice shortcut, break open the blocks down below, and then hit the flag at the very bottom. The next level is actually one of the longer ones that we've dealt with so far as we make our way all the way through it. I want to also mention there is one other ability other than the Maniacs that I won't be getting or using in the run, and that is the Juggernaut. The Juggernaut ability actually turns you into a tank, well, a commander of a tank, and you're actually inside a, well, a large moving tank, able to fire at enemies for as long as you have health. In this form, of course, you move rather slowly, but can take out enemies, of course, with the firepower of the tank, but it doesn't really come in that much handy, just like the Maniacs. Here we also grab a brand new ability for the very first time. This is the Fly ability known as Micromax. Basically a parody of the movie, well, The Fly from the 80s, and of course was originally released a year before that. As Micromax, we can climb on walls very easily and fit into areas that other characters wouldn't be able to do so. In this spot here, drop down through the openings and then climb up on the wall on the right side. Once at the very top, switch over back to the Samurai ability. Once you're in here, move over, try to get past the goat moving back and forth, and then start breaking the blocks downwards, being careful not to get squashed on against one of the walls by the moving back and forth platforms. Hug the right wall near the very bottom though, so you can open up and get past the metal gratings that cover the bottom portion of the last set of blocks, and then go through the teleporter to make it to another city level. It's a pain here as you try to make your way up through a couple of the ones that will end up being destroyed and then disappearing after you land on them. In case you end up falling at any point, you may have to come up a different alternate path. Climb up here and then break open the blocks. You'll be able to jump up to the top portion, then continue over to the right and actually go through the wall of the building in order to make it through a set of different staircases. Here, drop down all of them in order to make it to the flag at the very bottom. Next up, immediately climb up and grab the Cyclone ability once again. Once you've gotten that, of course use that Cyclone ability to fly through a large majority of the opening of this level. Watch out for the spikes spewing blocks and then go inside the giant dinosaur-esque dragon mouth, watching out for the spikes on the top and bottoms of his mouth, then go through here and use the Cyclone ability to hover downwards in order to reach the next flag. At the beginning of the next level, Sky Dragon Castle 2, jump across the first few platforms and then get on the teleporter to immediately teleport. Once you've done so, then use the Cyclone ability to fly all the way to the very top, very easily, in order to break open this block in the left corner. It'll take a little bit of maneuvering in order to actually hit it, but once you hit it, you'll get the Iron Knight ability. With this ability now in hand, use it in order to actually jump over this large gap here and then break through all the blocks on the bottom portion here to work your way back down to the bottom in order to reach another teleporter. Once you've gone through, here I'm going to restart the round just to switch over back to Kid Chameleon himself because he moves a little bit quicker and can jump a little bit better than the Iron Knight. Up here, grab the Samurai ability and then run through the actual opening in the cliff. Drop all the way down to the very bottom and then work your way between these totem poles and keep going over. Here you'll have to do a lot of jumping off the giant set of springs at the very bottom, watching out for the enemy, in order to eventually break open enough locks so you can climb out of this hole and back up to the surface. Here, run across, jumping on the giant killer whales in order to make your way over, and then keep going all the way past the enemies, dropping down this large hole that is end up being covered by one of those disappearing, reappearing blocks. At the very bottom, just to the left, is another flag. Now it's time for the next boss fight. Once again, we use the Samurai ability to help us out as we jump on top of the heads. The first head will end up slowly rising from the very bottom. We can keep jumping on top of it over and over again with the right timing in order to keep hitting him. Normally, he also keeps firing out boomerangs that can hit you if you try to attack him from the left or right sides of the giant head. Though they move rather slowly, you should be able to jump over some of them if you decide to face the boss head on. After you destroy the first head, work your way over to the right side and start jumping on the second head. Once again, watching out for some boomerangs that may get in your way, but overall it's pretty easy to keep repeatedly jump on his head. After he sinks down back down towards the bottom of the screen, he will reemerge a few seconds later, a little bit quicker this time around, though it's still easy to jump on his head. Once you've defeated the second of the floating, heady metal heads, work your way over to the left side and start jumping on the one on the far left. Same exact deal, same pattern, same boomerangs, and once he's finally been defeated, you can get the flag and move on to the next level. It's kind of funny, every time I say get the flag, it kind of reminds me of Double Dare, collecting all the flags that are on the obstacle course in order to get the next prize and move on to the next obstacle itself. At the beginning of the next level, we're going to be switching abilities once again. This time we're switching over to Eyeclops. Now, I showed Eyeclops off briefly by mistake earlier on in the run, but now we're actually going to use his ability. Like I said before, he can actually make blocks appear that you normally cannot see. Here, you'll be doing just that in order to get a hidden block to appear so you can actually use it to slide underneath this very small opening in order to make it through to the next teleporter. Once here, you'll have a large series of moving back and forth left and right of the screen with a large amount of bouncy blocks. On the very bottom, watch out for a whole bunch of drills coming out of the metal blocks to get to another teleporter on the bottom right corner. At the beginning of the next level, we end up switching off from the ability we currently had, and switch back over to our hoverboard friend. We're going to be here for a little while here. Use the hoverboard in order to get up to the top portion of the level, bouncing up and down on the ceiling part till you get over to the right side. Once over here, take out the giant mech containing the alien moving back and forth. The alien-like mechs and spaceships that you're going to be seeing are some of the more annoying enemies in the game. These guys will hunt you down trying to take you out, especially the flying ones. When they get over top of you, they will drop lightning bolts on you or lasers on you, trying to hit you. You'll do your best to try to jump on top of these guys or hit them so that you end up defeating them. They take multiple hits in order to defeat. Over to the right, while dodging a few more mechs and all, you'll eventually make it to the flag for this level. At the next level, it's one of those levels that, well, you have to run as quickly as possible. There's a few of these in the game itself, and basically you're being chased by a giant wall of instant death. You have to do your best and maneuver through all the platforms and perils in order to get to the opposite side of the level to complete it before you end up getting crushed. Going here, stopping here on this teleporter, as you can see a giant too bad over to the right in case you didn't quite make it in time, but hopefully you did and you're able to teleport to the next area. Here we have a giant set of trees on the left, center, and right. Work your way in between the trees, watching out for the giant demon heads, and make it to the teleporter at the very top. Right over the top portion of the level, watching out for all the totem poles that are set up, then go across the middle portion. Watch out that some of the robots here will try to fire at you, then go through a very small opening. Do the flip onto the top part so you don't even have to worry about doing the little bit of platforming, then break open this block in order to switch back over to the Cyclops guy. Once you become him, drop down, use his ability in order to get all these blocks to appear. Watch out for the spaceship moving along, and then once you make it over to the right, you'll have to deal with some mechs as you make your way across another set of hidden blocks. On the very far right side, you'll be able to drop through a very small opening, bounce along the way, finding a whole bunch of more hidden blocks. If you accidentally fall here or miss one of the hidden blocks, you'll land in the spikes down below. Once you get past these guys, you'll be falling once again. More of these mech guys will try to get in your way. If you're low on health, try to do your best to get this mech to come over to the left side, so you can jump on top of him to defeat him and then continue on. Here you'll have a couple more guys to get past, but thankfully you'll eventually make it to the flag and be able to move on. In the next level, you'll see another one of the giant lion enemies. You can actually bounce on their heads here in order to get up to the higher platforms on the side without having to change abilities. On the next screen, keep watching out for another lion guy, who will end up dropping off the platform after a little while. Get past all the arrow shooting blocks by running across them very quickly. Watch out for another set that's going to be lining a wall just past the opening that you go across the top of this area. Right past that, you'll have some more of the lion guys moving, and you can bounce on their heads once again in order to get up to a higher platform. Here, do some manipulating, moving back and forth to jump over, then jump over to the right side here, watching out for the projectiles that the lion guys may fire out. After a couple of more small jumps over little gaps, you'll be able to make it to another flag. One of the things that makes this game so fun to play is the fact of all the different branching paths that we've been showing and talking about throughout the run. Having so many levels and so many different ways to get to certain levels, every time you play the game, you could try something new and end up having a slightly different path. It would take a while before you're actually able to discover every one of the levels located in the game. Thankfully, it's easy to get across the next area by jumping in between the enemies, watching out for the spikes on the ceiling of the area, and you'll be able to make it to a teleport on the right. Here, on the next screen, use the cyclone ability to move in and out of the different blocks that will all have spikes coming out of them if you accidentally run into them. Do your best to maneuver all in between in order to get over to this area. Once all the way to the right, drop down a little bit with the cyclone so you can see this column and then actually go through it in order to make it to the flag on the other side. One other thing that's actually really cool is Mark Cerny, the programmer of the game, has actually worked on many of my favorite games. The Crash Bandicoot series, the Spyro the Dragon series from the original PlayStation, the Resistance and Killzone series, and even up to Knack for the PlayStation 4. In this level, we're introduced really to a new threat, and that are these weird ice-like blocks. These blocks we'll be seeing a lot more later on. Basically, when you jump on the bottom of them and hit them up into the air, they end up causing not only the block to appear above it, but also get blocks on the left and right side of it. Because of this, they pretty much go on for a long period of time, and the maneuvering around them can be rather difficult. We'll see a little bit later on a better example of those ice-like blocks. On the next screen, we become the hoverboard or sky cutter once again. Move across the top portion of the level to the left, then use the flipping jump move here in order to break open some of the blocks. Being careful of the goat enemies that may follow you down the platforms, depending upon how long it takes you to get the spinning to work correctly to take out these guys. Thankfully, they're not too difficult to deal with, though. Here, I'm going to move over to the right, even though I need the teleporter on the left, to cause the ram guys to come out a little bit, so that I can then open up the teleporter enough so I can stand on it and teleport to the next area, which I immediately become the berserker. Here, run across all the enemies. It's okay if you get hit once or twice, and then run into all these metal blocks on the right side. Push them all out of the way and then jump on top of them, and you'll fall through an opening on the right and then become the sky cutter once again. Really easy to make it through the rest of the area before making it to another teleport. Here, work your way down a little bit in between the two bouncing areas so that you can get on the solid ground between the trees. Keep going over to the right, jump over another one of those dancing couple guys, and keep making your way through. This is another level where you're going to be chased, so you have to move quickly. Thankfully, the hoverboard gives you enough speed to maneuver your way around it. Using the other abilities, it can be rather difficult to actually make your way through. Eventually, when you make it to the end, though, and the teleporter, the machine will stop once it reaches a certain point. Use the teleporter, and then immediately on the next screen, jump up here in order to become the micro fly guy again. Drop down just a little bit, ignoring that teleporter in the upper right, and instead go into this area, breaking open all the blocks that you need to in order to jump up and go through this very small hidden opening. Inside here, you'll drop down and find another teleporter. On the next screen, you'll have a whole bunch of those arrow shooting blocks. Thankfully, with the micro guy, if you time a quick jump away from one of those spikes, even when they're pointing towards you and shoot at you, you'll be able to manipulate them so that they won't actually hurt you. Climb all the way to the very top, make it to another teleporter, and then on the next screen, you'll become the cyclone guy again. Here, watch out for the evil cloud that's firing lightning at you to get to the very top of the screen. Once up here, keep using the cyclone ability so you don't have to worry about jumping from platform to platform on the very small blocks, and make it over to the flag on the far left side. Next is the interestingly named level Bagel Brothers, which happens to be another one of the boss battles against Heavy Metal. Here, go all the way over to the right side, find a hidden block, and become the samurai. You now have to take out the three giant heads. They each fire out weird plasma that you can either jump over or, with a nicely timed sword attack, actually destroy. For the first guy, work your way to the sewer area down below, and then keep attacking him as he moves to the left or right, depending upon what side you want to enter the sewer from. Then, when he gets all the way to one side, he'll quickly retreat to the other side where he started. Run along with him, being sure not to have him hit you, and then turn around once he turns around and slows down once again. Keep attacking him until he's defeated. Move up to the top portion of the screen here. You'll once again have to take on two of the floating heads in the more open area with all the platforms. With a little bit of timing, you can get some really nice spots to keep bouncing on top of their heads while actually avoiding most of the platforms. focus on either the top or middle head first, it doesn't really matter which one. And actually, if one goes off screen, rotate and switch to the opposite one so you can keep hitting that one until it goes off screen, and then go back to the other one. Once you've defeated both the giant heads though, you can move on to the next level. From this point on in the game, the levels are definitely going to get a little bit harder, the enemies are a little bit tougher to dodge, as well as just the overall cluttedness of certain areas definitely increases, with tons of arrow shooters, spikes lining the walls, and other pitfalls and perils that we're going to have to try to maneuver in between to get through these stages. This area isn't too bad, but there are a few of the arrow shooters that may catch you off guard if you're not too careful. Then you want to move in between the disappearing and reappearing blocks, being careful not to accidentally get caught right at the exact spot one may spawn, as sometimes it can end up causing you to lose a life. After going through a teleporter, you'll be in a little bit more of an open area just below where you currently were. Watch out for all the clouds that are going to be firing lightning bolts. Once up here, flip upside down, then drop down to the platform below with the teleporter, and use that in order to move on to this area. Do a simple flip, and you'll easily rise all the way to the very top of the area, quickly beating it. During the segment with the trees and the killer whales, try to do your best to keep at least one or two health. You want to maintain the hoverboard as long as you can during this segment. Once you've made it past all the killer whales, there's another teleporter. Immediately after teleporting, flip upside down to the top portion. Here, watch out for all the goats moving back and forth. The cool thing about the gravity move, as you've already noticed, is of course the helmet on his head will defeat enemies, so you can use this to hit a few of the guys along the top. The scorpion enemies are a little bit more difficult to deal with, as these guys cannot be hurt by jumping on their tails. If you do so, you'll end up just taking damage. You have to actually hit them in their head just past the spiky tail. After avoiding a few sets of the scorpion stingers, you'll find another teleport in the upper right corner to move on to another screen. Here, you'll have a whole bunch of the evil lightning bolt spewing clouds. They will try to do their best to absolutely hit you over and over again. Just past a few sets of rows, you'll see a giant wall of all the arrow shooters. Be sure to drop down or turn around away from them in order to avoid hitting any of them and losing the rest of your health. Here, manipulate the little guys that are going to pop out of the two platforms, then go past the disappearing and reappearing block section to find the teleporter on the left. That area is definitely tough and may take you a few tries to get through. Here we're going to be using our ability for the first time. Use the ability along with the start button at the same time in order to activate the force field. Thankfully, it keeps us invincible for just long enough to travel through the area and make it to the next teleporter safely. On the next screen, this area is a pain. The teleporter that we have to hit is a little bit of a troublesome one to get to. It's located right down here. To get down there, we're going to use the hoverboard and constant jumping with the helmet on our head in order to break open the blocks. Once you've broken through at least 3 or 4 rows of the double blocks, then drop down yourself and keep doing the manipulative flip jumps in order to break the rest of the blocks. If either one of the spaceships gets near you, there's one on the left and one on the right side, immediately take them out. That way you don't accidentally keep getting hit by them over and over again, as they will like to hover just over this pit and keep firing lasers down into it. Once you've broken enough blocks, you'll be able to make it to the teleporter. Flip and hover all the way to the very top. Go past a few guys over to the right and then drop down into this cave area. It's a little bit difficult, definitely, to dodge some of the dinosaurs firing out all the fireballs, but you can make your way all the way to the very bottom here, and here, you'll have to do a little bit more manipulating with the flip jump. We do not want to lose our hoverboard ability here, so in order to keep it, what we're going to have to do is break open all the blocks on the right side here. That center P block is another one of the abilities that we don't quite want right now. On the next screen, there's a whole bunch of rams and a whole bunch of different levels like we've seen multiple times. The quickest way through this is to use your hoverboard ability to break open a line of them and then flip in order to get in between them. Do this several times in order to get to the bottom row, jumping on top of the ram heads here and then going to the teleporter a little bit to the right of that. There's a lot of disappearing blocks during that section at the very bottom that will just leave the spike, so you have to be careful. Here we drop down to the giant pit, go onto this section here because this leads to the teleporter. The other ones will lead just to enemies and dead ends. As soon as you appear, be sure to jump because one of the scorpions is going to try to attack you. Drop down, kill the next scorpion, and then get into this corner over here with the two drill enemies. Jump on their heads a few times to get rid of them before even attempting to get on the teleporter. You can possibly sometimes get to the teleporter without even having to deal with those guys, but it's just safer and easier to take those guys out first. The next scene is a little bit more open, but that just means there's more chance for enemies as you work your way through. Watch out for a few arrow shooters and dragons and eventually getting to the flag. Do so quickly here, we see that we actually got a ton of bonuses for beating this level. The next level, titled Monster Island, is definitely one of the tougher ones so far. As we start off, there's a lot of arrow shooters. As soon as you hit the first set, it will start off a chain reaction that will cause a whole bunch of more to go off, so you have to be very careful and stand in one of the few safe spots to avoid it. After going past a couple of those little small monkey-like guys I talked about earlier, we then go through another series of just moving quickly along the platforms as shooters go off. Thankfully, these ones won't hit us. Throughout the entire area, and throughout a lot of the rest of the game, you'll see the screaming skull guys appear in the background. Whenever they appear, they do flash for a few seconds, giving you an opportunity to get past them, avoiding them all together, or move a couple steps over so that you can wait for them to spawn and drop, so that you can then jump on them in order to defeat them. If you're able to get up here, then use the hoverboard in order to slide all the way through a very tight area. You'll then have a series of metal blocks with the drills. Using some manipulation of gravity, we're able to get through this area relatively easily. Keep moving, set off a giant wall of spikes, and then do a flip so that you avoid taking damage from the top portion as those won't have shooters. Here, wait for some of the screaming skulls to appear and the enemy to move over so you can drop down to the teleporter for just a few seconds in order to move on to the next level. Here, it can be rather difficult to actually jump using the hoverboard, and unfortunately, I end up losing health by being in the same spot of one of their disappearing blocks. At any point in the game, when you end up losing your mask and go back to your Kid Chameleon form, it can be a little bit more tricky. You're going to be a little bit more cautious while jumping the platform. You won't have any special abilities to help you out, but thankfully you can still jump on enemies. As we climb up here, we're going to open up some blocks and keep going upwards. Now, I end up going up the entire right side here, though in all honesty, I could have immediately just gone to the other side, as there is another one of the micro abilities that I'm going to be grabbing in just a few minutes. However, I decided to climb up the staircase here and then jump up, trying to avoid the guy in the platform to the left of me. There's a few of those symbiote-esque slime guys that will spawn. As you climb up here, you'll grab the ability to turn into the fly. Now that I have that, and at least a little bit more health, I drop back down and work my way over to the left, jumping to the disappearing block set, avoiding the spiked ceiling, and then start climbing up. It's a little bit better to actually just jump up the individual platforms on the left here because you have a small window to avoid taking damage from the enemies themselves. Then, cling onto the left wall and keep doing short little jumps. Doing so, you'll be able to negate all the respawning ice blocks that keep happening. Either you can try to sneak under this one here, or just keep jumping straight up in order to keep destroying the blocks so that you can end up getting over. Once to this portion, walk over to the right and climb up in between these two columns that will lead you to the teleporter that you're looking for. Some of the other teleporters here will just take you to farther back in the same level that we currently are. On the next stage, immediately you can jump down, avoiding some of the enemies, and just walk casually for a few seconds, eventually breaking open some blocks with the arrow shooters so that you can actually climb downwards to this cave-like structure at the bottom. Here, just take your time. This is actually probably the easiest area that you have left in the game to travel through. There's not a whole ton of enemies, and those that are there are easily able to be jumped on in order to defeat. Here you may have to take your time for just a second for the right opening to get past this tank-spewing monster, and then make your way over to the bottom right corner, avoiding one of the spiky dinosaurs, to hit the next teleporter. On the next screen, since we still have the micro ability, start climbing upwards. Climb to the very top and get in between all the drill spikes that are coming out of the metal blocks in order to reach another teleporter. Here, try to do your best to manipulate the error shooter so that you cling on the wall and then immediately jump off the wall at the same time. If you do it correctly, you'll avoid taking damage from the shooters coming out. You'll bounce along a bunch of slime enemies, walk across another set of platforms to another area over here. You'll drop down a few times, avoiding the abominable snowman-like guys, then climb up this wall and break open all the blocks. Ignore the first teleporter and jump on the second one. For the next area, you have a bunch of these grabbing hands at the bottom, reminding me of the wall masters from The Legend of Zelda. Ignore all of them and just work your way across the actual single blocks to the left and then climb up. A couple of guys are up here, but they're easily able to be dodged around to get to the next teleporter. Here, I recommend taking out the UFO enemy or at least get him to go the opposite way from you so that you don't have to worry about him, and then go past the disappearing and reappearing block. There's some of the mech enemies during this segment that can be a little bit annoying, but they're not really that difficult. Here you'll climb up, still keeping hold of the micro ability for a little bit longer, then break open all these blocks and go to the right. Be careful not to get squashed by the disappearing block when it disappears, and then avoid the UFO right afterwards. You'll have a long series of a few walls. You can either manipulate the arrow shooters or just drop in between them and the wall that you can actually stand on, and then avoid some more UFOs. You actually do this a couple of times before reaching the next area. Try to avoid the mech as well as the other UFOs, but it's a little bit difficult. Just be sure to at least hit the teleporter for the few seconds you need in order to move on. Once again, as Kid Chameleon, I had to be a little bit cautious while trying to run through things before eventually making it to another one of the sky cutters and going back on the hoverboard. Thankfully, this part isn't too bad. There are some spikes for the drills coming out of the metal blocks, and there are a few other normal enemies. But with the hoverboard, we can hang on the ceiling itself. Trying to do my best to avoid the wallmaster-esque hands that try to grab me can sometimes not be avoided, and you'll take at least one or two grabs from these guys. You want to ignore the flag on the top portion and instead travel through the bottom cave area to make it to another teleporter. The next screen, just jump over to the right and hit another teleporter pretty quickly. Now this part can be rather difficult. With low health, I'm trying to do my best to avoid getting hit. The UFOs here are very malicious, and they will try to do their best to take you out. Here I'm able to get up into the upper left corner area just long enough, and it ends up causing the UFO guy to leave me alone for just a second so I can fall in between all the drills and move on to the next teleporter to the final level of the game. Now this one is a huge gauntlet, but thankfully we get health a couple of times during this stage. There's a ton of different arrow things, and everything that you basically fought throughout the game makes a little bit of an appearance during this level, where it's blocks that disappear and reappear, crushing blocks, metal blocks with drills in it, or various other things. Be sure to climb up here real quick to grab another heart, so that you have full health before going through the giant amount of arrow spikes that are going to be coming your way in just a few seconds. Take the top path, past the killer whale, and go through the hidden opening in the wall, then jump through the platforms or use the maneuvering with the hoverboard itself to get through the next areas. If you move quickly, you can avoid all the guys that spawn from the walls and try to jump at you. When I make it down here, I take out the ram guy before going underneath. Here, I jump onto the platform itself and then use that in order to actually get through the small opening. Right where that area was, there was another piece of health if you do need it in order to get through, but thankfully, the next two areas aren't too bad. It can be rather difficult to get through that area with the entire thing of arrows going up and down, but if you move fast and manipulate at the right time with the reversing gravity, you'll make it through without taking damage. Then avoid the last few enemies, and you'll make it to the flag at the far right, and it's time to battle the final boss of the game. The last level, known as Plethora. Now, unfortunately, I lost the sky cutter during the beginning of this part, and what I can do is come to this area right between these columns and grab the micro guy. Now there is a few other masks located in this area to help you out as well. The final boss is, well, heavy metal, as expected, but with tons of different heads all fused together, with one with a giant mustache at the bottom part of this tower of heads. When he's traveling throughout the level firing the little skulls and heads at you, what you have to do is go to the very bottom, manipulate him so that he starts to come down himself. Once he's come down far enough, you'll have an opening. Quickly climb up and then start bouncing on his head. If you're able to time it right with the right movements, you'll be able to get a ton of hits in before he ends up either getting too close to the ceiling to damage you, or one of those stray skulls ends up hitting you. Once all the eyes have been depleted from his head, he'll keep shaking and shaking, eventually exploding. We can grab the flag and see the ending to Kid Chameleon. So there you go, not too much of an ending, but at least it kind of wraps everything up. We then get to see actually a pretty cool credit scene of the Kid Chameleon team in the art style of the game itself, with all their names and all that. Now, Kid Chameleon for the Sega Genesis may not be one of the most memorable Sega Genesis games, but I think those who played it, the game definitely left an impact. The cool idea of having all the different masks and ability definitely added some unique flavor to the game. You couple that with all the levels that we had to explore, some pretty colorful graphics, and a soundtrack that's not too bad. Kid Chameleon is a pretty fun game. But with that, that's going to wrap up this edition of Play It Through. I'd like to thank you for watching, and of course, I hope you enjoyed.